The next item of business is topical questions. And at question number one, I call Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the cyber attack on the 4th of August 2022, which reportedly targeted NHS Scotland's patient management software.
Cabinet Secretary Humza Yousaf.
On August the 4th, 2022, we were alerted by NSS, NHS National Services Scotland, that one advanced a service provider for health and social care across the UK had experienced a cyber attack. The UK-wide incident was contained by the supplier within a few days, supported by the National Cyber Security Centre. Regular public updates on the cyber incident and subsequent recovery were reported by the supplier, one advanced, covering all systems impacted. The Scottish Government commented publicly at the time. The target for the cyber attack was one advanced and not NHS Scotland health boards. The Adastra system used by out-of-hours GPs in Scotland, which was the main system impacted up here, was brought back online in October. Let me make it clear, Presiding Officer, no NHS Scotland patient data was affected, and well-established contingency arrangements were in place to sustain effective delivery. All One Advanced systems have been tested and security checked, with close working by NSS with the National Cyber Security Centre and the ICO. I want to express my sincere thanks to everyone who's been involved in responding to this incident so swiftly.
Tess White.
Following the attack, NHS staff were forced to keep patient records on paper and in emails and in Word documents. There are serious implications for patients' safety, privacy and trust. Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm the scale of the data breach, including the number of patient records that were affected by the attack, and what measures were put in place to keep patient data safe as digital systems were restored?
Cabinet Secretary.
So let me just confirm what I said in my statement or my response just a moment ago, that no NHS Scotland patient data was affected. And also, importantly, this is a really important point that Tess White has rightly raised, that there was contingency absolutely put in place. So first of all, core systems, they were fully restored, and ongoing monitoring by Scottish Government resilience officials was very much in place. And we were working, I should say, on a four nations basis. This was an attack that affected every part of the UK. Local arrangements were also put in place to ensure resilience. And the contingency arrangements used had been in place for many years. They're well understood by both NHS 24 and indeed the service. Contingency arrangements included updates to in-hours GP records in line with standard processes. So the attack took place. The contingencies that have been well rehearsed and well known about were put in place. And I'm pleased, as I say, that no NHS Scotland patient data has been affected.
Tess White.
Planning Officer, the alarming reality is that with ongoing geopolitical turbulence, we're seeing more and more malicious attacks like these, and healthcare is clearly in the perpetrators' crosshairs. How confident is the Cabinet Secretary in the resilience of health boards to defend against future attacks? And does the Cabinet Secretary agree with the former Digital Director of NHS National Services Scotland that the NHS needs to up its game in the face of serious cyber attacks?
Cabinet Secretary.
So again, Presiding Officer, can I thank Tess Daly, Tess White, forgive me, for what is an exceptionally important question. She's absolutely right to say that there are improvements to be made right across the board, and particularly across Scottish Government, across public sector, but we are committed to ensuring those improvements around cybersecurity for all the reasons that Tess White rightly raises in relation to state actors as well as non-state actors. What I would give Tess White some reassurance around is that we work exceptionally closely with the National Cyber Security Centre. They, of course, advise right across the UK in relation to cybersecurity, and we have a contingency in place to deal with any attacks that do take place. So there's ongoing work. We work individually with health boards too, and again, I'll be quite frank and honest with Tess White in my response that there are some boards who need that further work from need that further support from Scottish Government, and we're providing that support.
Paul O'Kane.
Presiding Officer, it is shocking that this Parliament and, more importantly, the public may not have been aware of the scale and severity of the cyber attack had it not been uncovered in detail by a Freedom of Information request from Scottish Labour. It raises significant questions over transparency. Even by the standards set by his SNP predecessors, the Health Secretary's report card is shocking. In 2017, following the last major cyber attack on NHS systems in Scotland, the then Health Secretary, Shona Robison, came to this chamber, made a statement and pledged to launch an inquiry so that lessons could be learned. So can the Cabinet Secretary explain why he failed to come to Parliament and make such a statement? And furthermore, can he explain what impact this cyber attack has had on waiting times and figures in NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde?
Cabinet Secretary.
As far as I'm aware, it's had no impact, but happy to look into that and come back to Paul O'Kane with further detail. What I would say to Paul O'Kane is, of course, this cyber attack was reported in August by STV News, by BBC News, by The Guardian, by The Nine political programme, which I think Paul O'Kane, I'm sure, has been on numerous occasions, all in August. And, of course, the Scottish Government commented publicly at the time. I will double-check my records, but I don't think since that report and that very public, extensive coverage of the cyber attack in August and the intervening 4 months, I don't think I have had a single parliamentary question from Paul O'Kane, single piece of written correspondence about the cyber attack on Paul O'Kane, or a single request for an urgent statement from Paul O'Kane. If I have, and I stand to be corrected, I will, of course, correct the record. So while I am concentrating on my job within the Scottish Government, I'm afraid I cannot do the opposition's work for them.
Question number two, Katie Clark.
To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to tackle cancer inequalities.
Cabinet Secretary Humza Yousaf.
Can I thank Katie Clark for an important question? We continue to tackle cancer inequalities by ensuring equitable access to cancer services via our National Cancer Plan. That's backed by £114.5 million. We know that the earlier cancer is diagnosed, the easier it is, of course, to treat and even cure, which is why we continue to invest heavily in our Detect Cancer Early programme, which also focuses quite rightly in closing the very inequality gaps Katie Clark asks about. In order to continue to minimise inequalities, we're currently developing a new 10-year cancer strategy and earlier diagnosis vision, which will launch in spring 2023. This will take a comprehensive approach to improving the patient pathway for all, with a focus on reducing and indeed eliminating those health inequalities that exist.
Katie Clark.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Cancer Research UK reported this week that each year around 4,900 extra cancer cases are linked to deprivation in Scotland. What proposals will the Scottish Government lay out in its upcoming cancer strategy that specifically address this challenge?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Katie Clark for her follow-up too? I met with Cancer Research UK yesterday. I was speaking at the Scottish Cancer Conference. I'm grateful for the CPG on cancer who were involved in the organisation, and Miles Briggs for hosting that particular conference. I then met with CR UK after that conference to talk through their report. And there's a number of interesting points made, but I think ultimately the message from CR UK was very clear to the Scottish Government. In the new cancer strategy, they expect a laser-like focus on reducing the inequalities that exist. Now, I won't preempt that cancer plan. We've had many responses. I'm very grateful for all of those individuals and organisations that have responded to the consultation. And I will be looking to launch that cancer strategy early in the new year. Katie Clark would like a conversation in regards to that cancer strategy, then my door is certainly open to that. But let me give her an absolute assurance that reducing the inequalities, the cancer inequality gap that exists, is certainly a high priority for us.
Katie Clark.
I'd be very grateful to take the Cabinet Secretary up on his offer. As he knows, academics and public health experts argue it is impossible to tackle health inequalities without addressing wealth and income disparity, and Public Health Scotland argue that a reasonable income for healthy living, sufficient welfare provision and what they call an active labour market policy are essential. Will the Scottish Government be willing to carry out research to analyse whether these policies are actually being enacted or attempting to be enacted, particularly in deprived communities?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'll certainly consider the proposal that Katie Clark has asked us, the research proposal, obviously, Katie Clark, forgive me, has asked us to look into. What I would say to Katie Clark is that there is no difference, I suspect, between her and I in relation to her premise, which is that inequalities, wealth inequalities, undoubtedly lead to poorer health outcomes as well. And that's why the work we're doing within government across portfolio, for example, within the Whole Family Wellbeing Fund, is so, so important. And what I would say to Katie Clark, she'll know about our rapid cancer diagnostic services. We've just announced a further rollout of another two. We can see that the interim evaluation from the first three RCDSs show that there's been a very significant impact into areas of deprivation. I can send her the further breakdown of that interim evaluation, but it goes to show that through interventions, like the RCDS, that we can target and focus into those areas of deprivation, and that will result in better outcomes for all.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cancer Research UK's report echoes the evidence that we heard during our Health Committee inquiry into health inequalities, namely that socioeconomic inequalities drive poorer health, which we've just heard about. Does the Cabinet Secretary share my concerns that in the midst of a cost of living crisis, exacerbated by Truss's disastrous mini-budget in September, that the Chancellor's decision not to follow the lead of the SNP Scottish Government by matching progressive policies like the Scottish Child Payment and instead cut household incomes is going to have a direct impact on the health of many low-income households?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think there can be no doubt in that. I think even those in the Conservative benches would acknowledge that the UK government's recent actions have exacerbated those wealth inequalities that exist. And as I've said in my response to Katie Clark, we can do what we can from a Scottish government perspective, but frankly, where the UK government hold the vast majority of those fiscal levers, if those wealth inequalities are not addressed, then that leads to poorer health inequalities for all. And I've said quite clearly that in my estimation, the cost crisis is also a public health crisis. So look, we'll do what we can from a Scottish government perspective to reduce that inequality gap that exists. But in the meantime, I would appeal to all of those in the chambers, including those in the Conservative benches, to use whatever influence they might have to get the UK government to change course and to ensure that they're not making the cost of living crisis even worse for those people that are already suffering in our communities across Scotland.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The health inequalities that Katie Clark rightly identifies across all cancer diagnoses and cancer types are manifest directly because of income inequality. But there is one kind of cancer where we have manifestly more to do and we is in our power to do, and that is in terms of bowel cancer. I only learned today that we never really talk about bowel cancer in this chamber because we're meeting the target, the target for home care test kits being returned to the health sector, and that's because that target is only set at 60%. Presiding Officer, this is a screening programme that we extend to every adult of a certain age in our population, but we set the bar very low. Can I ask the Health Secretary whether his government will consider increasing the target for home test kit returns so that we might actually catch more people, particularly in income-deprived backgrounds?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can thank Alex Cole-Hamilton for a very good question and a very reasonable point for me to consider. So I will take that consideration away as part of our consideration, I should say, in relation to screening. What I would say is our bowel screening programme has been incredibly successful and incredibly effective. But I take his point about being more ambitious around that screening programme, so I will take that away and I'll revert back to the member.
Julian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There are significant inequalities in access to screening. For breast and bowel screening, uptake is 20 percentage points lower in the most deprived populations compared to the least deprived. For some, particularly those in rural areas, the cost of travelling to appointments will be unaffordable. Patients can apply to the NHS Low Income Scheme for assistance, but given the cost of living crisis, could the Cabinet Secretary review whether these payments are sufficient and are having the desired effect, and what other solutions and support could be offered at a local level?
Cabinet Secretary.
Again, can I thank Gillian Mackay for the question. She's absolutely right. One of the key areas where we see inequalities is in around screening. And that's why I'm very keen that we use our mobile screening units that we have to ensure that they are getting into those areas of higher deprivation. On top of that, through the National Cancer Plan, we have allocated £2 million over 21-22 and 22-23 to tackle inequalities in the cancer screening programme. This fund provided £5 million of funding over the previous 5 years to a number of projects. The specific aim was to tackle inequality and access to breast, bowel and cervical screening right across Scotland. But of course, I will consider the issue that Gillian Mackay has put to me and see what more we might be able to do in this regard.
Thank you. Question number three, Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps are being taken to tackle the illegal trade in puppies in light of the Scottish Multi-Agency Strategic Threat Assessment report that the trade is funding serious organised crime.
Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown.
The Scottish Government continues to work with a number of key stakeholder organisations and other government administrations through the Puppy Trade Working Group to disrupt the activities of those involved in the unlicensed puppy trade. We have also run several puppy campaigns over the past few years to highlight the cruelty of this trade, raise public awareness and provide advice on how to buy a puppy safely. New animal licensing regulations were introduced in 2021, which cover the breeding and selling of dogs, and further regulation is planned using powers set out in the Kept Animals Bill, currently progressing through the UK Parliament. Serious organised crime affects us all, and we can all play a part in reducing the harm it causes. Raising awareness of the nature of the threats we face is one part of that response, and the Scottish Government and its partners on the Serious Organised Crime Task Force oversee work being carried out to reduce harm caused by serious organised crime in Scotland, and will continue to use every means at our disposal to disrupt serious organised crime.
Jamie Green.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response? Illegally traded puppies generate around £13 million of revenue for serious organised criminal gangs in Scotland, fuelled no doubt by a huge rise in demand. Estimates are that one in four dogs that are purchased could be linked back to criminality and low welfare breeding. A number of very prolific serious crime gangs are operating right now in Scotland, both breeding within Scotland but also importing through the port of Stranraer. The government's own serious organised crime strategy barely mentions the trade of illicit puppy trading. There are doubts if that strategy surely is robust enough given the scale of this activity. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary for some statistics though? Because surely the law must be strong on this. How many crimes of this nature are reported to or investigated by the police each year? How many are then prosecuted by the Crown? Yep. And of those, how many are actually successfully resulting in a criminal conviction?
Yep.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I say on the last point that Jamie Green raises, different crimes, different elements of crimes can be recorded in different ways. So I'm happy to make sure that the answer I give to him covers all the different ways in which it might touch on the illicit puppy trade and provide that information to him in writing. But also just to challenge the point about how much is being done, the scale and the significance of the trade was the driver behind the Puppy Trade Working Group back in early 2018. It's a UK and Republic of Ireland multi-agency group, includes key animal welfare organisations, Scottish Government, DEFRA, HMRC, Irish Revenue and COSLA. And of course, he's rightly identified one of the ports of entry, and that's why we worked collaboratively with the Irish government as well. But the principal aim is to disrupt the unlicensed, low-welfare puppy farming and associated criminal activity. It is taken very seriously. Jamie Green, I know, is aware of the fact that much of what we say in relation to the SMASTA, as it's referred to the serious crime strategy, is not public for reasons which he's aware of. But I'm happy to make sure as much information as possible is provided to him to convince him that we are doing what we need to do and that further action is proposed, not least in relation to the age at which puppies can be transported, and also the extent to which dogs in late gestation periods, which is often hard to determine, are also going to be addressed by perhaps reducing the time at which a mother can be transported when she's pregnant as well. So we are taking serious action and happy to follow up in writing with the member.
Jamie Green.
I would appreciate those statistics in writing where they are available. Presiding Officer, they say a dog is for life, not just for Christmas, But the reality is that many of these dogs will live barely beyond Christmas. As such, many of them come with their own health issues, incurring huge vet bills and, sadly, dying young. It's also highly likely that right now there are online selling platforms advertising illegally traded puppies. I won't name and shame them because we do not hold parliamentary privilege in this place, but we know who they are and they know who they are. And it's shameful that they're not doing enough to tackle and vet advertisements and sellers. I'd like to plug the good work of the SSPCA, presiding officer, and their Say No to Puppy Dealers campaign. But can I ask specifically what the Scottish Government is doing to drive wider public awareness, to inform the public of both the risks and the dangers, but also the moral issues of buying dogs from dodgy dealers, given that their last campaign was over 4 years ago?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I've already mentioned that we do carry those publicity campaigns, but there are a number of other ways in which we can raise awareness, and I think Jamie Green's question has perhaps been prompted by a press release issued by the Crown Office, which draws attention to these matters. And obviously, when this master was published, again, it was highlighted at that stage. So we do these things, and we do it partly by working through other organisations. The member quite rightly mentions the SSPCA, with whom we work very closely on this. But we'll always look to make sure that we highlight it even more, not least at this time of year when it can be the case that people want to buy a dog or a puppy for Christmas. And I think to just find some common ground, we are both agreed this is an abhorrent trade and we should do all that we can to limit it, not least because the very transportation of some of these animals is very detrimental to their health. So we'll continue to work on this. And as I say, I'll provide the information I mentioned earlier to the member.
Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Further to that exchange, can I advise the Cabinet Secretary that my proposed bill, the Welfare of Dogs Scotland Bill, is shortly to be presented to Parliament. Its purpose is for responsible dog ownership, in other words, tackling demand as a way of dealing with supply of the illegal trade. And I associate myself with the exchange with Jamie Green. So far as possible, stopping online purchase from places such as Gumtree. And can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, who's not got responsibility for his portfolio, that he will perhaps look forward, as I do, to Scottish Government support for my bill?
Cabinet Secretary.
I am not unaware of Christine Graham's private member's bill. And just to say to her first point about trying to encourage responsible ownership, that's obviously got to cover people being conscious of where they've bought a puppy in the first place, just to go back to the previous discussion. But we do welcome the proposals that seek to improve animal welfare, including Christine Graham's Welfare of Dogs Scotland Bill. I'd like to thank her for sharing a recent draft of that bill. Officials are still considering the proposals, and I look forward to discussing, or rather the appropriate Cabinet Secretary, Marie Goujon, looks forward to discussing the bill in further detail once she's had the chance to fully consider it. Animal welfare, as we're hearing, is an important and emotive issue. I'm sure everyone in the Chamber will welcome the opportunity to consider what more can be done to strengthen Scotland's high animal welfare standards.
And Finlay Carson.
Thank you. We've already heard that Cairn Ryan and my constituency, unfortunately, has a reputation of being the main gateway from the Republic Island into the UK for puppy trafficking. And whilst the likes of Stenaline do a lot to detect the illegal trade, there are still puppies getting into the country. You know, the Dog Trust polled 2,000 puppy breeders, puppy buyers, and it showed that 30% were still willing to buy a puppy, even if they thought it had been illegally bred. So, given it's the run-up to Christmas, and there's going to be a high demand for these puppies, sometimes going for as much as £3,000, what additional support can you give the SSPCA and the police in my constituency to make sure that that trafficking doesn't go on beyond the port, where we hear of stories of puppies being sold out the back of vans on the A75 and A77?
Cabinet Secretary.
Support that I've mentioned already, which is to work in collaboration with the SSPCA in relation to Police Scotland. They have overall an increase of £40 million in their budget for this current year, but of course the operational methods by which they drive down this trade is a matter for them. I should say, I would hope the member would take some comfort though from the Serious Organised Crime Task Force, which is looking at this. It involves 13 organisations. That includes SOLIS, the National Crime Agency, COSLA, Police Scotland and others. And that refreshed strategy was published in February this year. And although the aims and objectives remain broadly the same, To go back to the very first point made by Jamie Green, which is about the fact that sometimes not just the appalling trade itself, but the proceeds from that trade can feed further illicit activity in relation to drugs. There's a very serious focus on this, but it's not possible always to be as explicit about the way in which we're trying to deal with this area, because obviously we don't want to forearm those that are involved in this activity. But he should be reassured there's a joint approach to this, and it takes in the Irish government as well as the UK government and HMRC as well.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions.